Hey Ranush, welcome back to e-learning session of TS College of Commerce, Valga. I am Assistant Professor Rajeshwari Sharma and today's lecture is for the BCom Semester 1 English Medium for the subject Business Economics. So, as far as the subject is concerned, in last few lectures we were discussing with the last chapter of second unit, that is Demand Forecasting, and today we are going to see the last part of that chapter, that is Methods of Demand Forecasting for the New Products and Limitations of Demand Forecasting. So, in last lecture, we have seen the methods of demand forecasting for the established products. So, there we also have seen what are the established products. Established products are those products which are already available in the market. If today I talk about the smartphones, so you see the smartphones of many companies like Redmi, Samsung, Realme, MI, then Nokia is available in the market. So these are the established products and the demand can be forecasted easily in the market. But when we talk about the new products, so new products are those products which are not yet introduced in the market. And therefore, when we talk about the demand forecasting for the new product, so it is comparatively difficult as compared to the demand forecasting for the established products or the existing product. So today we will see the various methods which can be used for the demand forecasting of the new product. So let's begin. First one over here is evolutionary approach. So what this approach says? This approach says that each and every new product which is going to be introduced in the market will be the modified or the updated version of an old product. Okay, it says it's going to be the improvement of an existing product in the market. Like if we see today we use the smartphones, almost everybody uses smartphones today, but earlier when there were no smartphones in the market, so we used to have the feature phone. So when the company might have decided to launch the smartphone in the market, so what it would have done, it must have taken into consideration the demand for the feature phone, and on the basis of that demand, the demand for the smartphone, that is the new product is going to be launched in the market, would have been forecasted by the company. So this way, evolutionary approach says each and every new product which is going to be introduced in the market is going to be the modified version of an old product, and that is why demand for old product can be taken into consideration for forecasting the demand of new product in the market. The next one over here is substitute approach. So what is basically the substitute goods? Substitute goods or substitute commodity is a commodity which can be used as a replacement of another commodity. Like tea and coffee are the substitute goods. You can use tea instead of coffee, or you can use coffee instead of tea. So these are the substitute goods. So what does substitute approach says? Substitute approach says the new product which is going to be launched in the market is going to be a substitute of the existing product or the old product. So therefore, demand forecasting of that new product can be done on the basis of the demand of that old product. Like if we talk about the electronic vehicles. So, for inducing or forecasting the demand of electronic vehicle in the market, the demand for the vehicles which uses the petrol or diesel to run can be taken into consideration, because electronic vehicles are going to be the substitute of the vehicles that uses the petrol or diesel. So, in this way, substitute approach says the demand for the already or existing product which is a substitute of new product can be taken into consideration for forecasting the demand of new product. The third one over here is growth curve approach. Now what is basically the growth curve approach says? See, growth rate of demand for a new product can be determined on the basis of growth rate of demand of the existing product. For example, nowadays we see there are many products of actual company is available in the market. Like nowadays we have Pond's Cream, we have pond's cream, pond's powder. Okay, pond's powder. Now, if company wants to introduce a new product, that is pond's soap in the market, so for forecasting the demand of that product, it can take into the consideration the growth rate of demand for this product, that is pond's cream or pond's powder. So what is there basically in growth curve approach? For forecasting the demand or the growth rate of the new product, it takes into consideration the growth rate of demand of the already available product in the market. So this is also one of the approach. Next one is opinion poll approach. Opinion poll approach is an approach which is directly the buyers of the particular product is concerned, in which the buyers of particular product is directly taken into consideration. The views and opinions regarding the new product that is going to be the launched in market is taken from the buyers by the way of enumerators, by the way of mail questionnaires, etc. And on the basis of that, the demand for the new product in the market is forecasted. So under opinion poll approach, there is direct inquiry from the buyers by the way of enumerators, company representative or the mail questionnaires. The next part is sales experience approach. Under the sales experience approach, what is basically done? The new product which is going to be launched in the market is offered in sample market first, and after seeing the responses for the product in the sample market, then it is introduced in whole target market. So this way, under sales experience approach, earlier whatever the new product is there with the company, it is earlier launched in the sample market, and after seeing the responses for the product in sample market, demand is forecasted for the product in the whole targeted market, and after that it is launched in the market. So this way, sales experience approach is used for forecasting demand for the new product. The next one is vicarious approach. Vicarious approach is basically based on the fact that there is no direct link between the customers and the producers or the customers and the company. Like if you are using services of the Jio, so you are not having direct connection with the Mukesh Ambani, okay? You are getting the Jio SIM through some dealers. So those dealers are the link between the producers and the customers. So therefore, under vicarious approach, the dealers are considered the link between the producer and the customers, and they are appointed by the companies to determine the preferences of the customer and to determine the acceptability of the product from the customers, because it is believed that the dealers know the preferences of the customers more than the producer, as they are close to customers. So therefore, in vicarious approach, the dealers are asked to collect the information about the new product which is going to be launched in the market from the customer, and on the basis of the data collected by those dealers, the demand for the new product is forecasted in the market. So these are some methods which are used for forecasting the demand of new products in the market. And as far as the demand forecasting for new product is concerned, it is more complex than forecasting the demand for the old products, as it is completely new, and without using or without actually seeing the product, it's very difficult for anyone to forecast the demand for it. The next one is, we will be seeing here limitations of demand forecasting. So first one over here is change in fashions. See, demand forecasting is not the task of one day. Production and the launch of product in the market is not the task of one day. It takes time, okay? It takes sufficient amount of time. So, for example, you are forecasting the demand for the jeans that you are going to put in the market after 3 months. Okay, that you're going to put in the market after 3 months, and your competitor has put that jeans within 1 month. Okay, so now what will happen? As your competitor has already put that product in the market, so it will be used by the it will also be used by your targeted customer. And then when you're going to put it in the market, so it's not going to be a new one, or it's not going to be a trending one, because there is already change in fashion in the market. So this way, if the fashion gets changed, so the demand forecasting for the product may also get changed. Okay, so therefore demand change in fashion is one of the limitations for demand forecasting. The next one over here is consumer psychology. As we have seen, while demand forecasting, we use different methods like survey of buyer's intention, and then we have seen opinion poll approach. So we use the different methods in which we take the opinion from the buyer. But when we talk about the opinions of the buyer, so it is a subjective concept. It is a subjective as well as psychological concept. So if the psychology of the consumers towards the product gets changed in the future, okay. And when we talk about the psychology of the consumer, so it is a phenomena which keeps changing very frequently. It doesn't remain constant. So it is one of the limitation in the process of demand forecasting, because due to change in the consumer psychological, demand forecasting may be adversely affected. The next one over here is uneconomical. When you are going for the demand forecasting of the product, so you have to collect the lot of data. For that, you have to appoint the enumerators, or even though you are using the secondary data, so you have to analyze it, so which involves the cost, which involves the time. So when we talk about the small firms, so they do not have the lot of capital to spend for the purpose of demand forecasting of their products, because demand forecasting is a costly method. So small firms cannot take the benefit of this. So therefore, demand forecasting is going to be an uneconomical one. The next one is lack of experts. As we have seen, we appoint the expert. Okay, when we talk about the Delphi technique or expert opinion method, so we appoint the experts. If we are not having the expert who is having the expertise in his field, or if the experts are not competent enough in giving the true picture of the market, in giving the true picture of your product in the market, in giving the true picture of the environment in the market, so it will have the adverse impact on the demand forecasting of your product in the market. Okay, so lack of expert is one of the limitation. Lack of past data. As I have told you, it's very difficult to obtain the past data in case of new products. Okay, and in case of old products as well, if the past data is available, but that is not reliable. So what's going to be there? The conclusion that is being derived from that data is going to be wrong, which will again have adverse impact on the demand forecasting of the product of a firm, due to which firm will suffer the loss. So when we talk about all these factors, so these are the limitations of demand forecasting. So here today I declare that we have completed the second unit of our subject, business economics, and I assume that you students are watching the videos, and in case if you are going to have any doubt, so you can contact us by way of WhatsApp group, or you can WhatsApp me personally. Okay, so stay tuned to our channel, keep watching the video lectures, and keep preparing for the examinations. Okay, thank you so much.